right.
Is Rust something that is used in the blockchain community outside? I mean, I'm
familiar
from Holochain. Oh, okay, what's it used?
Well, I don't know about the whole blockchain community. I don't know enough, but in this graph thing also uses IPFS, and IPFS, the main implementation is Go, but they have a Rust ongoing. So IPFS is D-Web, at least, even if it's not blockchain. Let's say Rust is used a lot in D-Web. I'm not sure about blockchain. I don't know enough about that. So many blockchain sub-communities. I'd certainly use Rust if I were working on this. The safety in Rust is quite something else. So Edge and Node, you're right. And I may have gotten misled. Okay, so we're discussing the Geo tool by Edge and Node that Michael put in our Slack in the related projects. And I saw a link from some of their GitHub, which doesn't have their main application, to something called the Graph Protocol. And the Graph Protocol is an interesting project which is about indexing things that happen on either IPFS or Ethereum so that you can do GraphQL queries against knowledge put on those chains. Well, IPFS is not a chain, but on these distributed web applications. And I do seem to understand from what little I saw of the Geo that they allow to create these little pagelets which gather information using stuff they found on the graph, verbatim, which I suspect is about stuff that's indexed by the graph protocol, though I have no proof. So the fact that you can index the web is interesting in itself. The fact that they're talking about, I think they're very naive about moderation, the way it's just, you know, anybody can put data and validate data. And it's like, okay, what happens when? There's a lot of what happens when that they haven't treated. But on the other hand, it's one of the few knowledge web on distributed web efforts that I've seen. And I think that's interesting in and of itself. I don't know if someone wants to add to that or react.
I have a general question. Isn't GraphQL not great for graph databases?
I wouldn't say so. GraphQL.
It doesn't allow you to transverse.
Traverse.
It doesn't allow you to, like, you know.
Traverse. No, define traversals. You're absolutely right. GraphQL is not a graph query language.
It wasn't designed for a graph database, to be clear.
I agree. Why totally.
They named it graph database because it's a Facebook graph, but that's not a graph. I mean, you know what
it's,
I
mean? It's a graph, but you cannot make graph queries against it.
Right.
Full agreement.
So okay.
Yeah,
it's great that you could filter down the data. That's what GraphQL is great for. It's funny that they're talking about, oh, this is a graph system, but we're not going to use a...
Well, it comes from Facebook. What do you expect from other than empty marketing claims?
Yeah, it's surprising that all these other... talk about graphs being kind of the future of the web and stuff like that, but they're using GraphQL, which isn't great at it.
Which is a pseudo graph. Yeah. One good thing about GraphQL is you can have functions and then you can hide the graph queries in a function call.
Okay, that's what I was wondering. How did they, because I see a lot of people using it now. And so I figured they must have found a way to express those queries.
There's a workaround, yes. It's not a good one, but there's a workaround. The official graph query languages, well, basically There's, on the one hand, declarative ones, like, of course, let's not forget Sparkle, but the big one is Cypher, right? The one pioneered by Neo4j. Cypher, a lot of people are using Cypher now. For example, there's a pretty interesting project called AGE that comes from Agents that is Cypher on Postgres. Unfortunately, only Postgres 11, but still, it's something. It gives you a cheap graph database implementation that is Cypher compliant and interacts with GraphQL in a non-trivial way.
Should I do the thing I was going to talk about, or I do a follow-up meeting about the, can you do graph queries on GraphQL?
No, sorry. If you had an agenda item, go for it.
Well, yeah, I said I would start chatting about source excerpts or, you know, media fragments, and
Sounds great. And apologies for sidetracking with this, and thank you for. Text fragments are important.
Oh, shoot. Okay, I was wondering why I couldn't see previews. So I have to open, apparently I have not shared with Zoom on this computer yet. I will think I'll have to rejoin right back.
Okay. But while we're waiting for Carl, there is a new effort to define something called JQL, which is supposed to replace Cypher, which is extremely interesting. Okay, excellent.
Ooh. Can you see my screen?
Yeah. There's a lot there. I could see it. It's gone.
And now he's gone.
No, nope. He's still there. Is he? Oh, no, you're right. He's gone. Damn it.
This is embarrassing. I should be better with technology. I saw a window that looked like, an interesting Zoom window, and I closed it. Okay, so now can you see my screen again?
Yes.
Okay. And I've never really done this presentation, so I'm moving you guys around. Okay, so apologies that this is probably a little overwhelming. I'm sort of in this process of synthesizing. You get in these habits of, I've got these ideas, take some notes here, I've got these, take some notes there, and I'm sort of synthesizing things. So this is sort of just a dump of, thinking on entities. And I guess maybe this is where to start, because this is sort of, what I'm interested in as it relates to connecting a system to the external world. So I'll kind of dive in. Maybe I'll mention the use cases first. So the idea is there's five use cases represented in this diagram. One of them is, it's hard to know where to dive in first. Sorry, I'll just dive in and hopefully it kind of makes sense, but I thought maybe I'd show you the page that shows how this is shown on a UI. So justification of a proposition. So I think I've mentioned before that, what people call claims, I tend to call propositions, just because I think a claim suggests that there's a claimer. And I think it's important to separate the two because, the different steps of the process. So justification by excerpt from a primary source. The concept of primary versus secondary isn't something that I have a concept of directly. It's just the things that they end up being when you excerpt them that way. So in the center here at the top is this proposition. Over on the left, we have all these entities over here are justification directly from some speaker. So I'm at this point where I think that there's maybe two basic parts of a so-called media fragment, or what I'm calling a source excerpt. One of them is the local representation. So which things about this, you know, distant information are you representing locally in the system? And I, things like that that stand out are quotes, screenshots, even the URL that you're going to click to go to the distant source. I mean, that itself carries information about the publisher, possibly the date, maybe the author even. So any of those things that are locally, let the person who sees it immediately come to some concept of, you know, is this valuable? Do I want to go look for further? Am I, or I'm just going to, you know, scroll past this, ignore it. And then the remote part. So the I call this a citation, because it's a thing that lets you go and find the situated information, the situated speech. So a hyperlink is maybe the most basic form of that. And ideally, you know, the closer it takes you directly to the statement, the better. So if it's a hyperlink with, you know, Google Chrome's, I forget what they call that thing, but text fragment or whatever, you can add some special thing to the end of a URL and it'll, Chrome will try and bring you directly to that text on the page. Or if there's an anchor element, you can get, you know, close to where the speech you've quoted is. Or if you're using a tool, like, you know, ideally some tool that would implement this, like how do, like a browser extension, it would, you know, find the text. So yeah, and then this, so this remote portion of the citation to go find the thing, but it could even be, you know, like an old school citation. This book, this page, you know, possibly this paragraph number, so you can go look something up, you know, without being online. All right, so proposition, justification. This page does not go into the details of, you know, sort of what justifications are and how they, like the various types of them, but the idea is just that there's something that, you know, proves a truth. I don't have a great word for this, but like a truth valence or a truth, you know, characteristic about a proposition. Is it, you know, does this justification say it's certainly true, more likely than, you know, more likely than before you saw this information, probably, you know, affirmatively neutral, like, hey, this is something we just can't know, can't have a true false about, you know, less likely than true after you learn this information, or, you know, dispositively false, like actually, you know, an untrue proposition. And then every justification has a basis. So what is the, you know, what is the thing that gives this justification force? I mean, the justification in a sense is just a relationship between this proposition and then some basis, you know, that humans see and then, you know, could derive a, you know, opinions about. And so in this case, we're talking about the excerpt basis and, you know, the other one basically being propositions. So you can use other propositions, you know, one or more of them to argue and come to a conclusion, sort of like an argument. Here, this excerpt, I'm also calling it a location, like this thing I was saying, citation or, you know, the remote part, but it's basically the thing that gets you to the actual substance of the source, like, or the excerpt of the source. And then there are sort of, metadata is the wrong word, you know, it's so overused, but there are, you know, sort of secondary information that you can add to an excerpt, such as the source, you know, which source does the system, you know, or I guess has a user input into the system that this source excerpt is part of, the source excerpt is part of. My best thinking right now is that a source helps you sort of track statements and even credibility over time, or I shouldn't say over time, but it could be over time, but track credibility and statements or propositions appearing in a source. So like, you know, what are the propositions that appear in, you know, The Economist, and, you know, do people like me tend to agree with them, or can I, you know, browse the most recent ones? How credible, you know, do people like me, or even me, if I, you know, I'm very active and I have a lot of votes, how credible do I find the Economist statements appearing in The Economist to be, or this, you know, this edition of The Economist? And then the other one, major secondary information being the speaker, like who do I think is speaking here? And these are optional. People don't have to add the source, you know, additional information. They don't have to add the speaker, but if they do, you know, then that now lets you track statements by a particular, what I call a persorg, just a made up word for person or organization, something that's capable of, you know, giving speech. So, you know, organizations, if they have a decision-making process, they can, you know, issue written things or have a, you know, representative speak for them. And so then they become capable of speech. So excerpt speaker is another relationship. It relates the purse orb to the excerpt. And so that's sort of this left-hand side, and it's just the basics, you know, the basic entity. Oh, actually, no, I should also talk about appearance. So justification is when I'm under the opinion that when I'm reading, I think I'm in one of two modes, and it's very fluid. You switch back and forth oftentimes in the same reading session, but the two modes are either constructive or what's the other thing I'm talking about? I guess critical. So sometimes I'm reading and I'm sort of open and passive, and I'm like, yeah, this person pretty much knows what they're talking about. I'm here more to, you know, consume what I'm reading information wise. And sometimes other times I come to a piece, I'm like, this is almost certainly full of, you know, garbage. I can't wait to find all the problems in this, what I'm reading. And that's the more critical mindset. But, you know, it's not either or. You know, you can read a piece that you flip back and forth, maybe in this paragraph, the person's, you know, off base, but otherwise you agree with them. Justifications are, I when I'm reading, I see, you know, say I'm reading media, you know, this research on prices article or journal article, you know, appearing in this prestigious journal. And, you know, I really love Professor Z, and I think probably anything Professor C says about prices is correct. So then when I see, you know, Professor Z say prices will increase, what I would probably do is create a justification for it, assuming I want to capture that. And it says that, hey, this, you know, speech that I've seen here, I think really proves this proposition, prices will increase. And I guess I didn't mention, but the authoring of propositions is one of the you know, fundamental, I think, creative acts in a system like this, because this one's very basic. You know, prices will increase, it's three words. It actually is identical to the speech that the person included. But you know, when you have, you know, real situated speech, it can be very nuanced to try and come up with the exact wording to capture that. So anyway, I mean, it's worth mentioning that this does not need to exactly equal the text that appears here. And, you know, frequently, you know, coming up with a good phrasing so that it's, you know, accurate but also concise is a challenge. So, but let's say I'm I oppose Professor Z, you know, academically, not really. I mean, I'm a different professor, and my own research is, you know, makes it clear that prices will decrease you know, soon, or whatever. Someone who just doesn't agree with the prices will increase. There's another option, which is in this critical mode, which is you're not capturing a justification, but instead you're capturing an appearance of a proposition. And so this is where you're saying, this is the speech that I think is here, you know, prices will increase, but, you know, I'm not saying that it justifies this, I'm just noting that it appears here. So, I think this is something, I was here for like half the meetings maybe, but this was discussed to some degree in the fall around media fragments, and I don't forget the terminology. Maybe appearance has now sort of become a front runner, but.
Trying to open the Trello right now. Certainly what you call an excerpt, I would call a fragment, and that's following the web annotation terminology, mm-hmm. In which I encourage you to look at, because they've done a standardized data format for a lot of that.
I've looked at it before, and I have not come up with any, you know, super duper more important, you know, locator strategies than, you know, already exist there in the web fragment stuff. But I guess in my mind, I just want to be open to a system saying, you know, there could be alternative ways to find this, like, you know, like Facebook post ID would be, you know, another locator strategy, because you don't really want to store the URL that someone happens to be seeing a social media page, because dynamic feeds can make it hard to, you know, find something again. But you can imagine a system that is, you know, is plugins or whatever, and it says, okay, I know that the person's on Facebook, I know that they're on this feed page, I can, you know, inspect where the text, you know, the text's parent in the DOM, and, you know, this is the Facebook post ID, or this is, you know, better example is probably Twitter, because it's, you know, more public. This is the Twitter, you know, post ID that this text comes from. And so now, you know, when they store it in the system, it's not attached to their feed, you know, which would, you know, maybe, you know, be based upon the current URL and, you know, like a text run, and then the text before, the text after. Is there something I was missing about the web fragment stuff?
Those are for text. There's also web fragment locators for, say, audiovisual in terms of time from here to there. At some point, somebody put more interesting ones, including go to web annotation fragment locators.
Is it on here, or should I search for that?
Yes, that's what.
Carl, I just want to mention for your Twitter example, I would generally have the tools extract the URL to that ID rather than storing the Facebook ID itself. So you never store feed URL, but every Facebook and Twitter both have URLs to the individual content. And I would store that because it has the ID in it.
Well, you can just store the ID and generate it too in case it changes. But yeah, I guess either way, right?
Yeah. I would rather have the full data and have a consistent format than having...
I'll come back to this.
You know, something.
It's fragment selector is the name. Sorry. CSS selector, expat selector, text quote selector, text position, data position, I think is the more general where you have start, end, SVG selector, range selector, and then you can have refinement. And then,
although to your point, Carl, having multiple ways of doing it is a value, and Mark Antoine may be correct that this one has enough different value types, so it's probably good to adopt, but I can understand your concern and your thoughts in that area. So I was just saying it for the Twitter example, I'd do it differently, but there might be use cases for, you know, a generic format, a generic kind of reader.
Cool. Yeah, thanks.
I've put the link that I have in my
Because at some point, chat. Like web pages are Google's working on cryptographically hashing web pages and serving them up regardless of the URL or something like that. So
I didn't know that.
Yeah, they did it for. Like if you have a signed web page, their AMP pages, they will serve up the page directly without hitting your server if you give them permission.
Is it part of the AMP project?
Yeah. Accelerated Mobile Pages was the original name of it. Not that you can access that directly, but you know, they're kind of moving in that way. And then I don't know the impact of IPFS. Mark Antoine would know more about that.
I was thinking, right?
Those are.
There are frameworks for making sure that what you publish on the web is also an IPFS and that protocol, for example, so that you'll get whatever version.
Yeah, so you'd want to store, so you wouldn't want just the URL in that case, you would want to store the IPFS locator.
Yeah, in that case, for example.
Because the URL is less.
And less what you can do actually is to put them together, like in the URL, you can have headers that would also give you the IPFS, and then you can store that. Anyway, that's all another story. But I think you didn't have the right page for the annotation model. I gave you the link in the chat. The other thing we were doing in the Trello, and I think that's really important, and I agree totally with you, is when we were trying to make the distinction, we never settled on the term, but the standalone claims versus non-standalone claims. And I think what you're trying to do with the prices will increase when you say, oh, it's really the art of making the good claim here is it a standalone claim? And it's true that a quote is more likely to be a standalone claim. This one, it's vague, right? It's what prices and prices of what and how over what time period and blah, blah, blah. So that's probably too vague to be a standalone claim, but I understand for the purpose of illustration, it's perfectly fine to say, and the question, yeah, exactly. And then you can get arbitrarily precise and which price index are you using, blah. But I think it's important to be able to capture the vague one as well and to say this is one possible precise rendition of the very generic prices will increase. And the justification then, like saying, and really, is the justification the excerpt, or is it the, I would say that it's the second sentence, the one you label sentence. It's, I think it's true that that price will increase because this exactly statement, Professor X said that prices will increase, Professor Z. And that's a justification. It's an expert argument, and it could even be a valid one.
Statement, you mean?
Yes.
Okay, yeah.
I don't know if the excerpt is a justification. It could be done that way, but I'm a bit skeptical. But the saying, the justification is Professor X said that the prices will increase. That's a justification. And this one, it's interesting because it's a more precise, even if prices will increase is vague, that Professor X said that prices will increase is quite precise, actually, especially if you have all the index provenance information.
Well, and as far as display of this goes, it would include the speaker and at least the proposed speakers and the sources.
Yeah. And that way, the form, the statement, the text form statement, Professor X said that prices will increase, is that, I would say that's the sentence form of the excerpt. I'm not sure how it's the sentence of the standalone claim above. Am I right?
So this one is a little bit of jargon from myself. So
okay.
First maybe just to mention about the statement. So statements are these sort of atomic entities similar to propositions, but where it's saying this person is saying that proposition, and the sentence relationship means what is the thing they're saying. And so you could even have three layers, but you could say this journalist said that Professor X said that prices will increase. And each one, the sentence is just my generic umbrella for proposition or statement.
No, I get it. So what you're saying is the statement is really what we should call a claim as such. And it's distinguishing what you call proposition, which we sometimes call deposit, right?
I haven't heard the deposit term, but yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, claim and posit, right?
Yeah. Well, we've been wavering on this one. I'm perfectly comfortable with distinguishing those two, by the way. I think it's very important. Okay, so now I understand better what the statement is about. It's the proposition plus truth value plus actor or person.
Yeah, and let me pull up this one, because this one makes maybe the justification of statement a little more clear, is that sometimes you have thorny situations, and I haven't quite figured this one out, but you have a journalist saying that an unnamed source says that the CEO says that the companies will merge.
Yep.
And I guess what I don't know what to deal with is the unnamed source part. Like, should that even be allowed in the system? I don't know. But yeah, so you have three levels of speech from, say, like this article. An unnamed source said that the CEO anticipated the merger to proceed. This is by a journalist. So
yep. It makes perfect sense to me. And each of them have, if you wish, a posit form and a claim form, right? And this is where I'm a bit, how much do we want to distinguish them? But I think we want to distinguish them. But a quote is both a posit and a claim. There is the notion that did Professor X say that? And it's being asserted. And it's being asserted in this case with the evidence being a direct excerpt with provenance. And that's not that's evidence. That's not a further layer of claim. It is claimed that Professor X said that indeed. And the evidence is the excerpt with provenance.
But I think what you're kind of mentioning here is this, I've added this as an implied justification. So when you have the posit, the proposition, and then you have justification with a speaker, that implies that speaker said the thing. And I agree that, well, I don't know if you're saying this, but I'm concerned that it's a little unwieldy having these sort of two paths. But so far, I haven't found a way for the system, I want to, you know, get rid of the two paths, at least entity wise and data modeling wise. I think maybe a UI could do a better job of hiding, you know, some of the details unless you click into
right.
But
no, that's extremely important. The how do we want to present this? It's true that when you have, by the way, the excerpt speaker, I don't think I'd materialize it. I just have the excerpt would have a link to the speaker, and right. then the basis can be the excerpt itself. You don't, I wouldn't add a cross table to excerpt speaker, or I don't see what it adds to materialize
the,
it.
The relationship between basically the persorg and the excerpt.
Yes. I well, say what, that could what be a direct wanted... link for a direct link from the excerpt to the speaker. Unless, of course, you want to contest that the person say that. But the point of the excerpt is that it's a way, like if I wanted to contest, I'd contest the excerpt. I'm saying that's a that excerpt is a misquote.
I agree, that's sort of a design choice. I'm falling on the side of it would be interesting to argue that directly, but I can see how you might want to have just alternative, like this excerpt with this speaker, and then that, well, sorry, this quote with that speaker, that exact same quote with a different speaker, and then people can, you know, choose between them, and, you know, and the system could aggregate on top of that and say, I mean, my concern, of course, is, you know, person comes to one, and they're like that, you know, I know for whatever reason, they just ignore it because it's, you know, factually incorrect and they miss that, that there's another one. But a system could, you know, say, hey, there are other versions of this, you know, if you want to like click to them or look to them. So
the basically the speaker link is contested, but I agree doing that without identifying the excerpt may be harder. You may have a point. It's true that in my representation, the excerpt speaker would be a claim in itself. So maybe I am actually closer to your representation than I am, even though I'm not a at the conceptual level. Okay, forget that. But I think we agree that there's nothing else in that table yet.
Nothing else in which table?
This is like... speaker. If you make it into a join table, you would not add any other field in that table.
But yeah, I don't think so. But I mean, it's possible things might target it. So you might... You might have, so this relationship might be something that you could then have, you know, pros and cons. Like, is it the speaker? Is it not the speaker?
Yeah, I agree totally.
Yeah,
that's it's a case we want. It's a case we want to handle. That's absolutely true.
What else might someone put in there? It hadn't occurred to me that there are other stuff to put in there.
No, I don't. I cannot think of anything else either, which is why I'm thinking, okay, how rich a join table is it, right? I mean, yeah. You won't join when it's many to many, but also when you have extra extra properties, and I can't think of any extra property here. So, but it can be many to many, certainly.
Mm-hmm.
Or multiply excerpts. I'm not sure. Let's keep that. For me, I would tend to make it part of the excerpt structure and say there's multiple excerpts that identify the same sentence at the same location and make the speaker constitutive of the, make the excerpt itself a join table with possible multiplicity at the excerpt level. That's not important. What is important is I see what you're doing with implied justification, and it's that, is that always implied though? The question is, if you create once I've created an excerpt and excerpt speaker, supposing I'm saying, here's the quote, here's the speaker, in a way, what may be implicit is the statement, right? The quote already says this speaker claims that sentence, that proposition. And is the claim is implicitly, is the claim distinct from the quote? Yes, it is. I may not need another object between them though. It's just the excerpt generates a claim And no, maybe not. Maybe he said something very vague. I was fine with the earlier version of this.
Well, I was changing it because if this changes, this has to change because this sentence, this portion of the entity is really just importing the target sentence in this model, the way I'm presenting it. So
right. Okay, I thought there was a distinct case where Professor Z says price will increase, and this is used as evidence for or justification for the more specific one, or vice versa, right? It can be justified from generic to specific or the other way around. But what's important is there's a quote and there's the abstract proposition. What I would do then to not change this is have another box, which is prices will increase, which would be the more vague statement, and then say this is an instance of that or a justification for that.
Yeah, well, I agree that this relationship between generic to specific is important. This diagram doesn't capture it all, so this doesn't show anything about relationships between propositions or relationships between statements. I'm interested in relationships between propositions and statements. Yeah. Let's see what
and quotes. What I'm saying is, I'm not sure that what you call a justification needs to exist separately. I see the point of justification between statements, but this is justification between a statement and a quote. And once you have a quote, you have, the quote gives rise to the statement and you don't need anything else, right?
Quote gives rise to the statement. I think you're trying to find, is there a way to deduplicate these two?
No, I'm saying, I think they're distinct, but I'm saying when you've created the excerpt, you've created the statement. It creates the statement and the proposition. What is possible is that you then use the statement that is very situated and say, and this is a case of this more generic or other formulation, or, you know, it's another formulation for the same thing, right? Maybe they said it will cause it to rise, and you said will cause it to increase, and we agree it's the same thing. That's just a different formulation of the same proposition. But it's possible that they said it will rise by 10%, which can be used to justify the more generic proposition, it will rise by more than 5%. And then it's a justification for this other proposition. But once you've had the excerpt, prices will increase, it automatically implies the claim, the statement, which is, according to Professor X, it is true that, like truth value, which again can be modal, can be likely or proved or whatever, that this proposition. What I'm saying is the excerpt implies the claim. Is it distinct from the claim? In a way, because the claim will be yes and no. Like the claim exists with Professor X, right? And then you'll have another claim for some other person, another claim for some other person, and you'll have a claim for, does this community, this organization believe that? And does the system believe that people believe this, which is totally what I call social truth. But normally, let's first deal with individual statements. And what I'm saying is the excerpt gives you the statement directly.
Yeah, I think I agree. And I think you're saying that basically this box should exist, this implied justification.
No, I'm saying it doesn't.
Why not?
It's a process. I'm saying once you have the excerpt, you create the statement. There should be a link between the excerpt and the statement, but that's it. You don't need a box.
Well, I think the box just lets the person see, hey, you know, let's say the person comes to this, they come to this page. Let's say this pro was not a pro, but it was a con. You know, saying like Professor X did not say that. So you need the system. So if someone comes and they land here, And if all you were to see was the con, even though this implication, you know, could be inferred and could be represented, they'd be missing out on the full picture. So I think it's important that this box exists and causes something to appear on, like, let's say this is your landing page, the statement. You need to be able to see that there is, you know, there is reason to believe that this was said. And the reason is this excerpt that was added sort of for different purposes. Because if you, all you see is this, you know, hypothetical con, you would, you know, not have the full picture of what the system could present.
If what you're telling me is you need a link from the statement to the excerpt speaker, absolutely true. I would put the link from the statement to the excerpt. That's what I've been saying, because for me, the excerpt speaker is implicit in the excerpt, but you've separated the excerpt speaker, so you need the link from the statement to the excerpt speaker. Agreed.
Well, if
does that link need to be materialized is what I'm asking.
So let me make sure I understand correctly. So, I mean, there's places this link could go. It could go directly to the purse org. Yeah, this is where I've put it to the excerpt speaker. You can set it up to the excerpt, but I mean, I think I see problems with anything other than the excerpt speaker, because the excerpt speaker is the only thing that says, the only thing it represents that this particular quote was spoken by this particular person. This one just says this person, but it doesn't tell you, well, okay, but why that person? I mean, what did they say that, or, you know, why do you think that they said it? And if you go here, it's like, okay, well, this thing was said, and you could do the leap of inference. Okay, there's the excerpt. Okay, there's the media that it came from. Oh yeah, that was the speaker, was Professor Z. But I mean, this entity is the one that says, you know, that it was Z that said that. That's why I put it here.
Okay, that's not really what I'm asking.
Okay, sorry.
Though it's true that for me, the excerpt speaker is implicit in the excerpt for me, and that's why I could have a direct link for excerpt, but that's not the point. The point
is- You would have a direct link from what to what? From PerSorg to excerpt?
No. I wouldn't have the excerpt speaker box. I just have a link, and I basically have the knowledge. I have the PerSorg as a field on excerpt. So the excerpt contains,
right?
And then of course the link can be to excerpt instead of excerpt speaker. It's not what you're doing. That's fine. I'm not arguing that. What I'm arguing is you want a link between the statement and the composite entity, which in your case is the excerpt speaker. Why not a direct link? Why do you need a box in the middle of that link? Why is implied justification materialized? I just have a link there.
I'd have to think about it. I mean, I put the box there, I think, partially because I needed some explanatory speech saying what it was. I'd have to think about it. Yeah, so if you're saying just a direct, you know, I don't know.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
You'd need to see a lookup table because there could be multiple implied justifications. I'd have to think a little bit more about what this is and why it's what.
That's a valid point. It's possible that the Professor X said it many times, and then there's multiple quotes backing that statement. That's possible. Mm-hmm. And there I agree. Many to one, one to many. I don't think it's a many to many, but I think it's a one to many. And that's why I said the excerpt with excerpt speaker, because for me they go together, will generate the statement.
It could definitely be a many to many because the same excerpt could be used for, you know, all the, like you're talking about all those alternative or, you know, more general, more specific claims. So yeah, it could definitely be a many to many. Different excerpts could all, you know, be implied justifications of the statement. But different excerpts, you know, could also be implied, you know, the same excerpt could be used to imply, you know, a range of propositions or, you know, statements about those posits. Prices That's will interesting. Increase. U.S. consumer prices will increase. U.S. consumer prices will increase in 2022.
Okay. Interesting. So that seems to justify the box. Excellent. So maybe we do have many to many. I'm not convinced, but that's interesting. But I think you're right about that instinct that it may be many to many. So I'll think more about this one. I think it adds complexity, but you have a good point.
Yeah, I would not disagree that this model is complex. I've been doing my best to get rid of everything that I didn't think was necessary complexity. So yeah, I'm glad we're having these conversations about it. Like this one, you know, is the excerpt speaker a separate, you know, thing?
From the excerpt, yeah, I would totally include it. Personally. But I understand there's a good example of necessary complexity is I can see Professor Z saying prices will increase in this media. And then a year later, they change their mind and say, no, prices won't increase after all, I was wrong. And so there's a proof that Professor X believed it at a given point versus what does Professor X believe now? Mm-hmm. And the belief, the statement, what happens to the statement, which is the association of a speaker in a proposition, which is not the same as just saying, this is what was claimed at point X, but this is what we now believe to be the current value of beliefs of Professor X at now.
Yeah, and I don't think I'm interested in modeling, personally, in modeling what a Persorg believes now. I don't think. I'm just only interested in capturing, you know, fixed media.
Fair fixed enough.
Media speech, which would, you know, basically be all be past. I mean, which of course would be interesting to see relationships between said this then, said this, you know, later, you know, and if they relate or contradict. But as far as like, can we try and figure out what the current, you know, what if you follow the path of all their statements, what's their current belief? I mean, I'm interested in users, like what do users tend to believe? Because that helps you give them good predictions. Like, okay, what are you most interested in seeing, or what's going to be most contradictory to your beliefs, that sort of thing. But
right. What you probably want to know is that this belief has later contradictions. Like somebody who heard that proposition, that statement, said, no, that statement is wrong because, and oh, look, it in this case, it includes the original author of the statement who backed one of those propositions. And that's an interesting fact. But in general, the general piece of information here is this statement was contradicted, not just in abstract, though somebody said prices will decrease, but saying this belief that it, this specific belief that it will increase for this rationale is wrong because, like, there's reasons to attack it knowing the rationale. That's really what's interesting to a user, I think.
Yeah. Well, now that you say it, there is an interesting reason for wanting to know a particular Persorg's, you know, statements about a thing over time because of credibility. So if a person, you know, made speech at one point that was, you know, we would agree is false, or some group would agree is false, but then they, you know, did some soul searching and they're like, no, it's true. Or, you know, the opposite is, you know, what I would say. And now that we would agree that's true, for, you know, what do you do with a credibility, you know, aggregation over that Persorg? You know, are they, you know, more trustworthy because they actually, you know, update their beliefs to be more true with you? Or do you average them and now they've averaged to zero because they had a very false thing and a very true thing? I'm not sure, but.
That is a fascinating question, but a simplistic version would be saying they made two predictions, one of which came to pass, which is better than most people.
Yeah.
Time's almost up. Any closing words? We should continue this. This is extremely important and interesting.
Yeah, and I thought we'd have more time to get to this. I wanted to share just what I thought a UI could look like. But yeah, I'd be happy to chat about it later. This slide deck's a little less polished because it's basically I don't know, 2 or 3 years old, and now I'm updating it, you know, with some newer thoughts. But I think this, I kind of was thinking, should I at least show this, you know, UI initially, or this mock-up, whatever you want to call it, because I think it gives an idea of just very basically how do I imagine some of these things being surfaced.
If we run out of time, would it be worthwhile to share that, or would it be without you sharing what it actually means? Would it be out of context? Would it not be worthwhile?
Oh, it's really up to you guys. I mean, if you want to spend time looking through it, I'm happy to have you look at it.
And I'd love it. Yeah.
Provide comments.
I'd love to, but I certainly want to go through it with you in detail because I think it's hugely valuable.
I know, Marc Antoine. Michael, what's your?
MClicks, MClicks.
At Gmail?
Yep. Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah, thank you.
Is it okay if it's just commenter?
Totally. Yeah. Or just viewers. Bentley? Fine too. I don't. All good. Whatever.
Comment Tim, because I like when if you have any feedback. But
perfect.
Put Tim and Steven and
Steven Juris. Tim
and Bentley.
What's is it just Bentley Davis? I don't know if I have Bentley's Gmail or Google account.
Bentley's leaving. Let me see what I have.
Let me send this one just so I don't lose it.
I agree.
Actually, can I copy
it? It's Bentley, BNTLYD at Gmail.
G? D?
BNTLYD. Yeah. Yes, that's the one.
I did have another question. Does the CDL have like a repository of examples like this, like the source handling that we went through? That would be really cool to see, to go back through as like a...
Like concrete examples or...
Like kind of like, oh, we just went through this example of kind of like a data model or an example of things that we went through, and just to store that somewhere as like...
Yeah, we should have a kind of neat index of all our... We have the Trello board, we have all kind of Google Docs, we have all kind of diagrams, this, that, and the other. We need an index of those. No, we don't. Let's actually work on the Google Doc of...
Well, this is kind of what I do is doc of docs, like, because I started to lose track of what was where, and I'd like to add, you know, some metadata, like, you know, this one was worked on from these dates, and then what are some of the contents.
Doc of docs is absolutely vital to any knowledge curating. Okay, folks.
Cool. We're thanks, everyone.
Ending now. And thanks, Carl. And let's continue this next week.
Okay. Yeah, sounds great.
Ciao, ciao.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.